So we usually have the music first, and then I give the message. And I always feel like when we do that, like, I always feel like, oh, we've already done so much. I can completely blow it, and we're fine. And after the advice guy and that, I feel like my work is cut out for me this morning. Otherwise, that was wonderful. But I feel like we're just, like, upping the divorce rate. So today, this is what I'm doing, is I want to tell you a story that I've actually told many times before that I heard years ago. And I don't know how many of you are familiar with this. The eighth graders in Mason County, every year they do an event for them that's a super cool event. It's called Truth and Consequences, and it takes place over at the Boys and Girls Club. And what it is, the idea behind the event that I believe is that a lot of times the decisions that we make, we don't connect the consequences for our actions. And so it's to help give these students a glimpse of if they continue to make bad decisions or if they start making bad decisions, where it could lead. And so what will happen is the students will come in and they'll like get a slip of paper and it'll say something like, your parents were out for the weekend and so you threw a huge party and some friends came over and the cops came. And so it's like, so this is what you have to do. And it's cool because like in this room there's like lawyers, the judge comes, there's health services workers, there's people from the hospital, police officers are there, the jailer's usually there. And so it like kind of takes them through. So I'd have to go through these things. And I think it's super neat. And one of the things I get to do is I often go through it with students and just kind of guide them along the way, which I thoroughly enjoy because I usually get some kids who are in our youth group. And so I get to come up to them and it's just like, you were smoking marijuana. And I'm like, you were? Oh my gosh. Never coming back to church. Like, I don't really believe that, but it's fun to go down that path. And then at the end of the event is, I think, 4 of the last 6 years, I've been able to speak to the eighth graders about making wise decisions. And every single time I've had the opportunity to speak, there is one story that sticks out to me that I want them to know. And I think sometimes in those events, people want to tell like horror stories, like, if this happens and you make this decision, you're gonna die. And I feel like we just like try to scare people into making smart decisions. And I don't think that's always the case. And so there's one story that always sticks out to me that I want to tell you this morning. And that is the story of Joseph Hooker. Now, if you're unfamiliar with Joseph Hooker, the bulk of his story happens in the Battle of Chancellorsville, which takes place in the Civil War. So this is in the spring of 1863. So it's about the midway point of the Civil War. And it's important to note that when our country entered into the Civil War of the North versus the South, it was kind of assumed that this war was going to be over in a couple months. It's funny how we repeat that same arrogance over and over and over again. But that was the idea, like the armies are gonna form, it's gonna be a couple months. North thought, oh, the Union's gonna be back together. The South thought, oh, they're gonna give up fighting us. And so this war has just kind of continued on. And so it's about 2 years into it, and the Battle of Chancellorsville takes place at a real turning point in the war. And so what's going on? The Southern general, who you might know, is Robert E. Lee. Robert E. Lee is considered one of the most brilliant generals in the history of our entire nation. He's kind of viewed as this just like brilliant military strategist that he just knew what to do. He knew how to rally his troops, and he's just considered this incredible guy. Now, he does something in this war that I think is incredibly important that he only makes one exception against it, and it really comes back to bite him. And that is the fact that he stays in the southern states. Because he kind of viewed it as like, we have seceded, we're fine, the North is trying to bring us back, and so if they want to bring us back, they have to come get us. If you I know this area better, our supplies are much better, and so we're just going to kind of hang out in the southern states, and we'll let them bring the war to us. And because of that, the North has suffered 4 significant losses recently in these battles to Robert E. Lee. Now, the armies have kind of come together again, and they're about to prep for this battle, which we know is the Battle of Chancellorsville. But at first, the armies are kind of faced off against each other at the Rappahannock River. Now, the Rappahannock River, in some places, is a great river. It's absolutely massive. But the interesting thing about this river is in other spots of the river, it's incredibly narrow. Like, there's spots of the river where it is less than 150 feet across. Which makes this incredible dynamic because we have the Northern Army on one side of this river and the Southern Army is right on the other side. And so there's really no other point in time that these two armies were that close to each other and yet weren't engaged in battle. And so there's this like super neat dynamic that like the Northern Army would have musicians come in to entertain the soldiers, and the Southern soldiers would begin shouting requests to the Northern band. Play Dixie, do this. And like similar thing, like Southern soldiers would have people come and entertain, and the Northern soldiers would all just kind of line up on the river and watch and be entertained by the same thing. They would trade back and forth. The Southern soldiers would kind of send tobacco up the river, and the Northern soldiers would send stuff back. And the interesting thing is, because they were so close to each other, they could really get a feel for how the other soldiers were doing. Like, otherwise, you could just go into battle, and one person wins, and that's about all you know. But they could really tell the morale of the other group of soldiers, which was an incredible problem for the Northern Army. Because President Lincoln at this point in time, he's getting extremely concerned because there's some things that are wrong with his soldiers. For one, they were promised pay. If they enlisted in the army, that they would be paid. They hadn't been paid for a very long time. They were promised, you would just assume this, they were promised food. And because most of the battle of the Civil War at this point in time had taken place in the southern states, they were having incredible difficulty getting food to the soldiers. And the other thing was illness was super common in the Northern Army camps. Like dysentery was spread throughout the entire camp. And so they're at this like incredibly pivotal time in the war that like the armies can actually see each other and can converse on each other. And it's becoming more and more apparent that the Northern Army is not in a good position to fight. And so President Lincoln, he feels this pressure and he makes a really, really quick decision that he knows, I need a victory. And I need, first off, to do something to rally the morale of the troops. And so he removes the general in charge and puts in place a man known as Fighting Joe Hooker. Now, Fighting Joe Hooker is considered to be the ultimate man's man. When he walked into a room, he was usually a head taller than everyone else. He was one of those people who people just like naturally admired and looked up to. There is some story that because of his last name is where we get the name of people who were paid money for sex. That is actually not true, although it could be true along the way from Joseph Hooker's exploits that are detailed throughout Civil War biographies and historians along the way. And so Joseph Hooker is just considered this like incredible guy. And so immediately as he walked in, people naturally looked up to him. But he makes a couple decisions right at the start, as soon as he takes charge, that just inspired the troops. First off, he promises they will be paid. And he kind of gives this tagline, but if you don't win, it doesn't matter. But you will get paid. I promise you that. The second thing is he promises that they will eat meat once a week. Now, for us, we just kind of, oh, okay. But for them, that was a big deal because they never knew if they were going to eat another meal or where it was coming from. But he makes this huge promise. I promise you, not only will you eat, but at least once a week, you will eat meat. And so naturally, the troops are like, they're excited, morale kind of rises up right away. And then Joseph Hooker, he's an incredibly, incredibly intelligent man when it comes to military strategy. And he does something that had never been done before at that point in time. And in many ways, it predates what we have today. He started what at the time was known as the BMI. And that stands for the Bureau of Military Intelligence. Now this predates the CIA we have today. But he started the Bureau of Military Intelligence. And never before had there been such a focus group that their specific role was to gather intelligence on their enemy. And so he starts this group and he just sends it out and he says, your only job is to know as much about Robert E. Lee's army as he does himself. And so they got to work and they quickly established a spy network and did all these different things to figure out what Robert E. Lee was doing. One of the first things they did is they cracked Robert E. Lee's codes as he was kind of sending out his communications to the different parts of his army. They were able to crack his codes. And so they almost immediately knew exactly what Robert E. Lee was doing. And then they figured this out. They figured out that Robert E. Lee had cracked their codes. Now, Robert E. Lee didn't realize that the Northern Army had already cracked his communication codes. But they found out that Robert E. Lee had cracked his. And so they begin feeding him all this false information about what was actually happening. And so they have this massive, massive advantage from the start that they knew what he was doing. And they were telling him all the wrong stuff about what they were doing. And then he does this other thing that was a brilliant technological innovation at the time, is they made use of a hot air balloon. Not that hot air balloon, different hot air balloon, okay? And so what they would do, because the armies were so close together, right on the Rappahannock River, is they would just send this hot air balloon up in the air, they'd hold it with a rope, it'd get high enough that they could see for a couple miles, and people would look out there, and they would go, okay, so Robert E. Lee, he's got, okay, that many troops, and they're there, and they're there, and there, and then they pull the hot air balloon back down, and they tell Thomas Hooker, they tell Joe Hooker exactly what was going on. And so he's got this massive advantage that he knew from communications what Lee was going to do. He knew exactly where he was, and so he has every advantage. And this is what he did, is from the different counts in the hot air balloon, he knew that he had 131,000 soldiers, and that Robert E. Lee only had 64,000 soldiers. And so he has got him outnumbered by over 2-1. And so you would think, because they're on one side of the river and they're on the other side, they would go, hey, we're 2-1, we're going to win no matter what, that they just kind of go across, they take them over. If the fighting went long enough, they would surely win. There wouldn't be a problem. But Joe Hooker's a smart guy. And so this is what he did. And what he does next is considered by military strategists to be one of the most brilliant moves in the history of war. And so what he does is he splits his army into three groups. Now, you couldn't see that if you were just looking across the river, okay? Because they were kind of all congregated together. But he splits his army into three groups. To one, he has them go just about a mile down and crosses the river. Now, Lee sees this coming. This happened in the late afternoon, early evening. He has them just go down about a mile and cross the river. And Lee watches this happen and he thinks, it's not a big deal. Like, they were here. And now they're here. This is not a significant problem for us. We're still fighting the battle on the same front. He lets it happen. Figure, I'm outnumbered by that much. I'll go ahead and let them make this move. And so he does this move kind of later in the day. And so Lee would be given the impression that it's the only thing that they're doing. But this is what he does next. And it's so brilliant. Is at 2 in the morning, he instructs over 30,000 of his soldiers to get up as quietly as you can at 2 in the morning, to march 20 miles down the river, cross the river, and then come 19 miles back and settle in the city of Chancellorsville. And so when Robert E. Lee goes to bed that night, he thinks the army is here, and he wakes up in the morning, and he's surrounded on three sides. And the soldiers panic, and they think, we have no chance. Like, we've got an army sitting right on our right flank, we have an army sitting directly on our left flank, Hooker himself is where he was at the time. He's blocking the path to D.C., and our only chance is to retreat south back to Richmond. And this is what Joe Hooker does next, as everyone assumed he was going to attack right away. But he doesn't do that. He goes to the group that was settled in the city of Chancellorsville. He goes over there. As he's going, he gets correspondence from the president, President Lincoln. And Lincoln kind of sends him this correspondence. If you attack Robert E. Lee, and if you win the battle, and Hooker doesn't even hear the end of it. He just says, send it back to him. There is no if, but only when, Mr. President. And then as he marches in the city of Chancellorsville, he has this large stage set up in the middle of the city, and he gets up on the stage, rides his horse up to it, gets up on the stage in front of all the troops. Now remember, no battle has been fought yet, but this is a celebration. They're already in party mode. And he gets up at the top of the stage and he says these lines. God Almighty could not prevent me from victory tomorrow. Now, there are many people who view that that statement right there is the prologue to the Battle of Chancellorsville. But I believe it tells the entire story. Because the Battle of Chancellorsville is not a story about military strategy. It's not a story about one set of troops outnumbering another set of troops. The Battle of Chancellorsville is primarily a story of pride. And Joseph Hooker's pride in particular. Now, we need to pause right here. Because there are many different views and many different definitions as to what pride is, and maybe more clearly, why pride is wrong or how it damages us. And I think anytime you think of pride, I hope this metaphor sticks up in your head. And so imagine this. Imagine that you want to go to a concert, and your favorite band, the band you have loved your entire life, for some of you that's not a very long life, but your favorite band is coming into town, and you desperately want to go to their concert. And so you're excited, you're there ready ahead of time, you've been listening to their music, and you eventually, you save up enough money to buy tickets to this concert. Now, you don't have anyone to go with you, but that's fine. Like, you don't care. You could absolutely care less. You are going by yourself. And so the day of the concert comes, you're incredibly excited. You put on your best concert-going clothes, which normally for most people is just kind of pick a shirt, pick shorts, sunglasses, weird hat. I'm good to go. And so you kind of, you march off, you're ready to go to the concert, you find a parking spot, which is ridiculously expensive as always, but you think, I don't even care, I am so excited about seeing this band finally, they are my favorite band, I am just pumped up, nothing can ruin this day. And so you kind of make your way in there, you find your seat or where you're supposed to stand along the way, and you're excited, and so they bring out the opening band, and You're just so pumped up. You clap, you cheer, you yell, you sing along even though you don't know the songs because you're just so excited that your favorite band is about to play. And then they kind of have that spot where the stage resets and you just can't help yourself. You're tweeting all your friends, I can't believe I finally seen them. This is the best moment of my life. Forget about the birth of my children. I'm more excited about this. Like, that's how pumped up you are. And then the band comes out and you think, this is my moment that I have been waiting for. And they come out, and you're so excited, and you're ready to just enjoy it. And the moron in the seat in front of you pulls out their phone to tape the concert. Now, do they tape it here? No. Do they tape it here? No. They feel the need to tape the concert right here. And so you stand back, and you think, oh, this is, it's just the first song. It's not that big of a deal. I can handle it. But the first song comes and goes, and their hands are still up here taping the concert with you standing directly behind them. So you like kind of move around and you can't see anything. And that's it. And so you kind of look around and you can kind of see some of the lights. You can kind of see some of the things that are going on. But there's so much that is happening on the stage that you want to just be able to enjoy and be part of. And you are stuck watching it on the small screen of the person in front of you. They do not have an iPhone 6 Plus. That would make it better. They have original iPhone, we'll say that. And you're watching this thing that you have so wanted to see through the small screen of the person in front of you. And that's what pride is. Is pride, more than anything else, limits your view and closes you off to the world. You see, there's like, you look back and you're just like, I want to see that person interact with that person. I want to watch this person do this thing. And you can kind of get a glimpse of the whole thing, but it's severely limited because that's what pride does, is it limits our view and it closes us off to other people. For one, is it closes us off to other people's perspective. There are no other good ideas or good inputs or good perspectives, because if you have pride, you automatically view that my perspective has to be the best in every single situation. And so there's no room for gaining wisdom or gaining insight. Another thing that pride does is it closes you off to other relationships. Like, there's no room to have a caring, loving relationship with someone else if you are too wrapped up in yourself. I'm going to show you an example of this. I found this recently on the internet. There was a lady who was sitting at a coffee shop, and she started to observe what she realized was the worst first date in the history of the world, primarily because the man was completely wrapped up in herself. And so she did what we should all do in moments like this, and she live tweeted it, the worst first date ever. And so I just want to read this to you to show you as an example how pride closes us off to relationships. This is a number of slides, but it starts with this. Watching the couple on what appears to be a terrible first coffee date at the table next to me. Dude is every precious self-involved writer. I'm writing a screenplay. It's about this guy who never really feels like he fits in, like he's just different. She keeps politely asking him questions. Not once has he asked her about herself. Wait. He just asked if she'd ever dated a writer. He's now complaining about the body of the coffee, telling her he knows a place that doesn't over-roast their beans. Now, those of you who complain about the body of your coffee, know how the rest of us feel. Keep going. Writing is really hard. People don't know that. It involves a lot of introspection, a lot of wrestling with your own demons. People tell me I look like James Franco. Girl works for a nonprofit. Dude is condescendingly explaining to her why most nonprofit models don't work. He looked into making one once. Every single thing she mentions, he did that one time with my buddy and is now an expert in. Girl, I actually love cooking. Dude, oh, you should try my puttanesca sauce. Did I say that right? Yeah. Oh, let's just assume I said that right. My friend who's a chef says it's even better than his. Oh no, now he's talking about how his fear of having children stems from his daddy issues, and I cannot. And then this is, and she relays this and other things, that the girl has been, throughout this entire time, texting someone else. Like, she just keeps, like, sending these simple texts back and forth, and then she gets a phone call that we don't know if it actually is or not, but she says is her mom, and so the writer realized that the phone call kind of went like this. Oh, really? Oh, so you don't think you turned it off? Okay, well, I can go check it for you. And so she turns to the guy and says, I'm sorry, my mom left her stove on, and she lives really far away, and so I need to go check it. And so this is the next insert in the conversation. Dude, do you want to go and come back? Girl, it's pretty far. Maybe we can do this again next week. I'll text you. Out the door like a shot. And then this is the last insert. He just opened his laptop and started typing. I hope it's a sad story about his life. But that's what pride does. Pride closes us off to other relationships because there is no room for love or care for someone else if you're focused on yourself. This is why affairs are so incredibly destructive. Because the essence of what a marriage is supposed to be is when you look at someone else and you say, I love you more than I love me. And so when you get to the moment of an affair, what you're saying is, I only care about me. So pride closes us off to other people. Another thing pride does is it closes us off to God. There is no room to look up if you're always looking in a mirror. If you are prideful and you believe that you are the center of the universe, and no one would ever say that, no one would ever stop and go, I believe I'm the center of the universe, that's the problem. No, but if your life is lived revolving around you and your desires and your wants, then there's no room for God in your life because you have, in essence, become your own God. And so pride limits us. It closes us off. And it is as if we are seeing the world through a small screen held by the person in front of us when there is so much more that's there. Now, that's not to say that all pride is bad, because there is some good pride. There are some examples where pride is not a bad thing. You should feel good about your abilities. You should. You should have confidence in your gifts. That's not a bad thing. You should feel good when someone tells you you did a good job. Or you should be aware when you did a good job with something. That's about being aware of reality. It's also okay to kind of have a warm-hearted admiration for different things. The Apostle Paul, one of the leaders in the first century church, he actually writes in one of his letters how he boasts about a certain group of people and what they were doing. And that we could say, like, ooh, the Apostle Paul's taking pride. No, he's going, this is great. You guys are doing great. It makes me feel good. I was a part of that. I feel like I led into that some, and this is just the best thing ever. So there is a good pride. But there is also a bad kind. Pride that closes us off and forces us to only focus on ourselves. And so the question becomes, how do we identify that pride? How do we figure out if we have bad pride? And as I was researching this and going through different things, one of the examples that someone gave, which I don't think it's a bad idea, I think it's just severely limited, is they said, well, here's how you can tell you have pride. If someone asks you, do you have pride in your life? And you answer yes, then you have pride. But if you answer no, then you really have pride. I was like, okay. So, but the problem with that is there are people who I know who don't struggle with pride. That they are the opposite of pride. They're incredibly humble. And so how do we figure out where we are on that spectrum? And I would say, for one, honestly, if as we're talking about pride, if you're thinking about someone else, then you have a really bad problem. Like, if you're only focused on others who have pride, then there's an issue there. But how do we identify humility? And one of my favorite quotes on humility comes from C.S. Lewis, and he says this: humility is not thinking less of yourself. It is thinking of yourself less. It is not thinking less of yourself. It is thinking of yourself less. And so the question is, how focused are you on you? How much time in the day do you spend worrying about your needs, your desires, your wants, your accomplishments, or your abilities? How much of your mental space is dedicated to thoughts that involve yourself? Because any time that is the case, what is going to happen as a result is we are going to limit our view of the world. And I think one of the worst things that we ever got an idea about is we thought that faith is limiting. And I've heard people say, like, oh, I don't go to church, I don't do that. I don't want to limit my life. And if we actually look closely, what we see is the exact opposite takes place. That if there is no room for faith in your life, if there is no room for God, then the person who ultimately ends up at the center of your concern and your needs and your desires is you. And that as you move into the realm of faith and begin to look at God and search for Him, what you see is that quite literally a different world opens to you. Because you can now engage those around you, where before there was faith, the people around you were merely competition. And now they are unique beings created in the image of God who see the world through a unique perspective and lens that you can take part in. You begin to see that God sees things differently than you, that you don't have the corner on the truth market, but that He actually does. And as you begin to pursue Him, the world quite literally opens up before you. And so we could say it like this: that your life is limited to the degree that you are focused on you. Could we put that up there? Your life is limited to the degree that you are focused on you. Now, how do you get rid of it? How did Joseph Hooker get rid of pride? Well, you have two options. Option A, we'll refer to as the existential moment. This is the moment in time where all of a sudden something happens, whether it's good, most often it's bad, where you begin to realize that you don't have it all figured out. Most of us opt for Option A. I'll tell you Joseph Hooker's story in just a second, but I would like to present before you that rather than destroy your life first to figure out you're not the smartest person all the time, maybe you should opt for option B, which is to listen. This is what the book of Proverbs says on option B. Two verses. Proverbs 18:2. A fool finds no pleasure in understanding, but delights in airing his own opinions. And in Proverbs 12:15, it says this: the way of a fool seems right in his own eyes, but a wise man listens to advice. Those two verses tell us something absolutely essential about life. Fools keep making statements and talking, while wise people listen and ask questions. And so maybe that's the best test for you in terms of that degree. How often, how much of your day do you spend making statements? And how much of your day do you spend asking questions? When you're around those around you and your friends, are you just excited to tell them what you've experienced? Or are you excited to hear about what's going on in their life? Because I watch people. I enjoy it. And sometimes I watch people go through almost a conversation competition. And they keep having to outdo each other about different things that happen in their life and who did it better. And the reality is that there's no relationship there. It's just competition. And so that's what the book of Proverbs presents before us of this is wise, is will you listen? Rather than experiencing a colossal failure, will you listen? But Joseph Hooker didn't realize that. See, after he had Robert E. Lee surrounded on all sides. The assumption was that he was immediately going to attack. That like, he was just going to just kind of grind him down. He had him surrounded on three sides, and that would be the end of the battle, and Robert E. Lee would be absolutely decimated. But he does something different. He says this. He says, I will not attack. He will have to attack me, or I will go get him once he is retreated. Which at first seems to make sense. Like if he attacks me, we're in a better position. And an army is never more vulnerable than when they are retreating. And so there is some insight and wisdom there. But what we actually see, it was arrogance. That he didn't want to just win the battle. He wanted to crush his enemy. And so what happens is that a whole day comes, and there is no battle. The soldiers are just sitting around. They're kind of doing nothing. And then the morning of the following day, one of his officers, a guy by the name of Daniel Sickles, he goes off to kind of gather part of the intelligence. He was a part of the BMI in some ways. And he sees that Robert E. Lee has turned his army from by the river, and he is now heading south. And so he sends word back to Joe Hooker, and he says, Lee has turned south. And then there's this interesting thing that happens. Sickles says Lee has turned south, and Hooker tells everyone, Lee is retreated. Now, that's not what he said. He simply said he's turned south. But in Hooker's frame of mind, he assumed that Lee retreating was inevitable. And so that was the only plausible explanation for Robert E. Lee's actions. And so he begins to tell everyone, Lee has retreated. He's headed back to Richmond. Tomorrow, we will hunt him down. So they go throughout the day, assuming that Lee was retreating. About that afternoon, some of his spies that were hidden in trees throughout the area, they begin sending word back. He stopped. He quit going south. And word gets to Hooker, and he hears this, and he assumes, well, he's probably just taking a break. Surely he's going to continue retreating. He's probably just taking a break. And the word comes back from other spies, and they say, he's setting up his guns. Like, he moved south, but now he's setting up his guns. And Hooker goes, that's nothing. We've already won. He's retreating. We'll hunt him down, and it'll be fine. And then he closes off all communication to him, and he has officers at the gates of his tent, and he won't let anyone in. Different soldiers come up, and they go, he's preparing for battle. We watched him. We went and see his guns were set up. He's arranging the soldiers in formation. He's preparing for battle. But after Hooker's commands, they won't even let him in. And then that night was meat night. The big promise that Hooker gave at the very beginning when he took command, that once a week they would eat meat. And so even though all of these reports are coming in, that Lee has quit turned south, that he's turned around, that he's prepping his guns, that he's preparing for battle, Hooker assumes that he is still retreating, that they will hunt him down tomorrow, and he orders that the cows that were at the back of the army be slaughtered because tonight is meat night. Now, this is important to know. This is a rough map of Chancellorsville around the time of the Civil War. And what you can see is there's lots of trees in the different area. That blue is the Rappahannock River. Is on the left side, where it's got that word core in the middle of it, is a big open field. And that's where Hooker and his army are. And so they're in this big open field, and they're all kind of settled down. They like the protection from the trees. And so they all sit down in the middle of this field, and they begin eating the meat that had been prepared for them. And as they're sitting there eating, some interesting things happen. First off, they hear like a rumbling in the ground. And they're sitting there eating their meat, and they hear this rumbling thing. Is that an earthquake? What's going on here? And they go, well, that's weird. And they go back to their meal. And then just a couple minutes later, hundreds of quail begin flying out of the forest. And they fly straight across the army, straight across where they were, and they fly past them some way over their heads. My guess is they kind of turned, covered their plates a little bit. Some of them got a little messy. That's fine. But like hundreds of quail just fly out of the forest, fly across them, and they kind of go, well, that was really weird. Then like a minute passes, and hundreds of deer come running out of the woods, and they run right past all these soldiers who are sitting there eating meat, which is humorous. They run past all these soldiers to the other side. And the soldiers are going, this is the strangest thing we have ever seen. And then Joe Hooker himself stands up in the middle of the field and says, "Surely this is a sign from God that he is delivering Robert E. Lee into our hands. May God have mercy on his soul, because I will have none." And then, almost as he finishes those words, the Confederate soldiers come charging out of the woods, bayonets at the ready, and they rout Hooker's army. And we go, how did that happen? He had him outnumbered almost over 2-1. He had him surrounded on three sides. But he had pride. And so it limited his view. And he couldn't see what was right before him. Now, this is what's absolutely fascinating. And in some senses, pride is contagious. It's because after this great victory by Robert E. Lee, and he has defeated this army, I think he all of a sudden went, well, maybe I can win this war by myself. Maybe I don't need help. And so for the first time in the Civil War, he marches into Northern Territory, assuming that he was now going to take on the Northern Army, leaving the terrain that he knew and the supplies that could easily get to him, and he marched to the Battle of Gettysburg, where the South suffered such a crushing blow that it quite literally turned the tide of the war, and the North went on to march to victory after that. Pride limits our view. And what we see is this, is that woven into the rhythm of life, woven into the way we live, is a temptation to believe that I have all the answers and that I have everything figured out, that I don't need help or assistance from those around us, and that my perspective is the best. And every time we do this, every time this takes place, we close ourselves off to other people's perspective, we close ourselves off to other relationships, and most importantly, we close ourselves off to God himself. Because there is no room for faith in your life if you have become your own God. And what I hope you see today more than anything else is an understanding that pride limits, but God expands. That as you pursue faith, you begin to see the world in an entirely different way than you ever could have before. In Isaiah chapter 55, verse 8, it says this, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts."